All right, it's really great to be here. The storm is moving in. Still have electricity, which is great. They expect about 6 inches in the mountains here overnight, which is quite a bit. And we're ready for it. Let it come. The meteorologists are actually pretty accurate. They said at 4 o'clock it's going to start raining. 4 o'clock it started raining. So a lot of people give them grief because they seem to miss it occasionally. Well, they're pretty good. They're pretty good at it. It's not a perfect science by any means. Prediction is not a perfect science. You have some hits and you have some misses, etc. We're talking about the coming storm in the world. And it's forming. You can see the form. It's just like a satellite. You're looking down the Gulf of Alaska, for instance, and you see this big pressure system. It's winding up clouds, and you see the jet stream, and you see the pressure systems where they are in the United States, and you say, you can pretty well tell, okay, here comes a storm system. We don't know how strong, when it's going to get here. You can kind of guess at it. Do the best you can. Guesstimations. But you can tell that there's a lot of moisture and it's headed your way. Same thing with human events. You can tell there's a lot of red flags. There's a lot of momentum in certain directions. You have the domination by what's called the intellect right now. Those people who have reached high positions in academia, through the valuing the intellect. Those who value the intellect are in charge of the world right now. And it's been a gradual replacement. There used to be that people valued those who had what's called character more than intellect. Now, it's basically, if you have the intellect and the intellectual charm of it, then character doesn't really matter. People don't really care anymore. Where in the past, it was the opposite. If you weren't like some real intellectual, charismatic type of person, but you had a really strong character and you had a deep abiding faith that there's something greater than the intellect, greater than man, greater than the world, something greater, call it God, call it whatever, there's something greater and we should not take pride in our intellect. Those types of people in the past were honored and given the high positions in society. Nowadays, that's completely reversed. It's those that really have a mocking attitude, those who place the intellect, the intellectual human on the highest pedestal, and as if they were God. Those are the ones that are now elected to office. Those are the ones that have positions of power in the world and that most of the world reveres and respects those type of people, which is a disaster. And I've been trying to point that out. And I don't hate anyone or anything here at all. I'm not trying to get anyone to hate me or any way like that. I'm just pointing out the facts of the situation in general terms. Because it's important to realize that, not for the purpose of panicking or getting frightened of the future, etc. Just the reverse. It's to motivate us to see our options. Because if we don't see our options, at some point we'll panic. At some point there'll be panic. When you are used to your surroundings and everything's on autopilot, and you think, I'm functioning great. But if you're taken out of those comfortable, familiar surroundings and you're placed in a very different situation, you suddenly realize, oh my gosh, I can't cope, and then you start panicking. So with this world, with all the changes that are happening, with a very much changed playing field, at some point people will say, wait a minute, I don't think I can function very well under these circumstances of what's going on. And at some point, panic, certain type of panic could set in. Where you realize that character doesn't count anymore. It's only the will up to authority of the intellect that counts, and you don't have that, and you say, hey, you know. So it's super important to see your options. Now, today was a great day for me because I touched upon what would be called, what I would call enlightenment, realization, the goal. I touched upon it. I was on the fringes of it. And I just taking a look at it, saying, wow, it's there. There's something there. It is tremendous. And I was very comfortable just being very close to it. And what does that mean? I don't know. I'm not predicting anything, but I got to that point. So it seems as though there's a lot of positive momentum in that direction that I can comment on. And it's all the more important to comment on it because there's a lot of momentum in what I call a very negative direction of turning the intellect into God, trying to worship the intellect as if it were God. And that is not a joke. That is not a joke. They're saying today, I was listening to an advertisement on the radio, and they said, Merry Holidays for something. It just didn't fit. I said, you know, do we say, at Thanksgiving, do we say Happy Holiday at Thanksgiving, or 4th of July, Happy Holiday, or Easter, Happy Holiday, or President's Day, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, Labor Day, Happy Holiday. We say Happy Labor Day, or Happy Thanksgiving, Happy 4th of July, Happy... But at Christmas, we say, Happy Holiday. Have a Merry Holiday. And I said, well, what holiday is it? It's Christmas. So why is everybody so religiophobic? They're so religiophobic, it's incredible. And people are just, oh boy, you dare not use the word Christmas. But very few people are actually offended by that. And yet everyone's acting as if this is like some great crime if you say, you know, Merry Christmas. You have to say Happy Holiday or Happy Holidays. I said, wow, it's amazing, amazing. That's a red flag right there too. The intellect cannot stand anything that reminds it that it is not God, that it is not King, that it is not the end all and be all, that it is not capable of fixing all the problems, so to speak. It cannot stand it, and it wants to get rid of anything that reminds it of its own inabilities, because then it feels very insecure. So what does it do? Stamp out all that stuff. Now people say they're religiophobic because of all the wars, religious wars and all that stuff, which have happened, of course. We don't argue with facts. But if you add up the last 100 years and take what those under the influence of the intellect, trying to make the intellect God, what they have done over the last 100 years, Soviet Union, China, Cambodia, maybe places in Africa, I know, just, you know, there's all, Germany, Japan, we're worshiping the intellect, really, and wanted to get rid of God. And they said, no, we're supermen now. We're super people because we have the intellect, and the intellect is guiding us to utopia. If you add up all the atrocities and all the killing, all the horrible stuff that they have done over that just the last century, 100 years, is, you know, what is worse? What is worse? I'm not saying either are good, but what is worse? It's certainly putting the intellect as God is worse, way worse. So there is no high moral ground to say have a merry holiday as if that is somehow bringing peace to the world. It is not. The lessons of history are that it is not. The most dangerous thing that can happen in this world is to overvalue the intellect and put the intellect on a pedestal and believe that it has the answers. This is the most dangerous thing that can happen. So it's better, actually, for people to at least acknowledge there's something greater than the intellect, which at least religion does that. That's the least that it does. It says, hey, let us remain humble. Have humility, be humble. Let us not exalt the intellect. It's a very dangerous thing. And people intuitively know, through the lessons of history, and probably cosmic lessons, that it is a very, very dangerous thing to do. And what have we done? We've gone right into that danger zone. Right into it. And we are in it. We're in that pit right now. So it's super important to recognize that you are not in that pit at all, which is what's called enlightenment, which is different than saying you're in the pit, but you're climbing out. That's a whole different thing. That's the intellect. The intellect tells you you're in there, but it knows a way to get you out. What truth, divine reason, inner clarity, voice of clarity tells you is that you're actually not even in the pit at all. You're just imagining the pit. You're imagining a proxy for yourself in the pit. It's all hypothetical. There is no pit. You're not in the pit at all. And that is actual, what saves you is realizing you don't have a problem. You don't have a problem. You really don't. We don't have any, no one has any real problem at all. No one. It's only a hypothetical situation. You don't have an actual, no one has an actual problem. So you can be in the problem-free condition. But you already are in that. You just have to accept it, actually. And that's what I did today. I started accepting it. I said, hey, I don't need a problem. Because who needs the problem? The intellect needs the problem. So it can solve a problem, so it can prove how great it is. Reality is not trying to prove how great it is. Has to who? To what would reality prove that how great it is? It doesn't need to. There's nothing there. There's only reality and nothing else is real. So all reality knows what reality is already. There's no need for any proving anything. It's only the intellect that needs to prove how great it is. How does it do that? By having problems and supposedly solving the problems. So it's the intellect that needs problems. What we are doesn't need any problems. And I saw it, and I felt it, and I realized it to a faint degree today. I realized that to a faint degree. And I just said, wow, this is the road to enlightenment. This is the road. And it's right there. It's right with us. Right with us. We just say, I don't need any problems. I don't need any problems. I don't need for this to be a problem. I don't need for that to be a problem. And I started naming everything. Specifically, I don't need that to be a problem, and went through everything possible. And then there was like a few things that stuck with me still. But by and large, I was able to go through almost everything and say, I don't need anything to be a problem for me whatsoever. Again, only the intellect needs problems. It's the intellect that's asking for problems. And this whole hypothetical scenario of problematic scenario is there. Feeding this intellect saying, look at all these crises, look at all these troubles. The intellect says, I can find a way to solve these crises. And of course, these crises are only hypothetical because it comes from our desire to change reality, which would certainly cause a crisis. It would cause the annihilation of reality if it were possible. And we're symbolizing that annihilation as a series of crises that go on billions and billions of years of more and more crises constantly being doled out. And the intellect is trying to learn how to deal with these crises as if we have some means to overcome the annihilation of reality and still, you know, have a new kingdom or something. And the intellect is sort of the new prime creator, as it were, the one who knows, who can figure it all out. It's only a dream. There's nothing to figure out. What we are doesn't need any problem to solve. We're already problem-free. We're problem-free. We have no problems. What we are has absolutely no problems whatsoever. Now, in this world, what happens if you come into this world in the problem-free acceptance of problem-freeness, you would stand out like a freak. So, you know, what we do here is we actually take on problems to try and cover up the fact we don't have any problems for those who want us to seem normal. That's what happens. Rarely do you get someone who comes in the world who simply says, I have no problems whatsoever, and they just don't compromise at all. And they say, if you want me to teach you this fact or help you accept this fact, I will. If not, I will just sit here in a heap on the floor. But that has happened, that those came in the world, I don't have any problems at all, none. And we're all exactly the same way. None of us have any problems whatsoever. And if we accept that in this world, then what happens is what's called miracles start happening for it, where our problems get taken care of us by the grace of God automatically. Automatically. The only reason why it's not happening for us is because our intellect keeps saying, no, 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 I want the problems because I want to prove how great I am. And how can I prove how great I am if I don't have problems? How can I prove how spiritual I am if I don't have sickness that I can push back, get rid of, that kind of stuff? That's still all the play of the intellect. We can literally shift into a feeling. Our feeling is that we don't have any problems, totally carefree. And then whatever needs to be dealt with in the world, it seems to be automatically gets dealt with in what seems to be just a continuous, miraculous way. That is literally, I saw that, and right on the fringes of that. And I say, hey, this is true. I saw it and said, this is true. Now I can see it very clearly. That is really a tremendous thing. Now, I also saw something else this evening, which is very important to share. When you're on the path to recognizing this, that you don't really have any, you don't have any real problems whatsoever, none, you're going to be working with it. As you work with it and turn it around, you're going to have all different kinds of perspectives on it. And you'll see glimpses, and then you'll look at it this way and that way. Everybody has different perspectives on it. So what's super important is to don't compare your perspective with someone else's perspective. Super important. Gets you nowhere. Because tomorrow, you may have a completely different perspective. You will have these shifts where you say, whoa, I see it differently now. Okay. So when you get into a comparison, you're more interested in defending the way you're seeing it right now rather than continuing to deepen your clarity so that it changes and gets even better. So what I have done is I've tried to never compare myself with anyone else where I'm at. I don't even want to know about anyone else's path or what they're doing. It's not important to me whatsoever because I don't want to compare at all, which is why I've tried to do the path on my own without in any group situation, because when you're in a group situation, people tend to start, hey, where you're at, share, you know, and comparing where they're at, and then they start, maybe get very defensive, say, whoa, I'm not very far along, and I need to try and adapt someone else who seems higher up what their perspective is. That doesn't work because your path's organic, and it has to develop according to your own clarity and where your own clarity leads you. So comparing where you're at on the path with someone else is a big, big no-no. And the only one that can not do that is you. You're the only one who's in control of that. You have to say, forget it. And I always got that clarity, the voice of clarity always conveyed to me like, hey, don't compare, forget about where someone else is at. Don't pay any attention to that. It's not important. It's going to slow you down severely. Now, what about teachers then? What about those who are helping motivate us and clarify, etc.? Well, the truth is, actually, very factually, is that the teacher should be off the charts. So flawless, perfect, and established, they're off the charts, and you don't even think about comparing yourself with where they're at. Because if you start comparing where you're at, the teacher becomes competitive. It slows you down, actually, because you think you have to leap where they're at, and they say, I want to be like them, so I'm just going to mimic or parrot what they're saying, and it messes up your own path, because you have to internally, you literally have to see things for your own self, and you have to actually look at the situation, and whatever you're seeing, that's where you're at. But it's the effort to see that's all important, not only what you're seeing, but the effort to see, and that you can't fake it, you have to do it. So if your teachers or mentors are off the charts, completely off the charts, you don't even worry about them. I don't compare myself with Ananda Maima. I don't even think about it, because there's just no way. Just forget it. Don't even think about it. And she'd say, don't ever compare yourself with me. Forget about me. Don't even draw comparisons. It's a waste of time. Waste of time. And it's just accurate about that. So ultimately, it's better to have these super ambassadors of certitude in the world than it is to have lesser teachers. It's better. It's way, way better for us, actually. Because then we just say, poof, forget about comparing. I'm not competing with them. You know, I'm just going to listen to what they say and keep plodding along. I'm not even going to think about comparisons. So it is better for any teacher to try to distance themselves to the point where people just don't feel like drawing comparisons and being in competition with them. If you get too chummy and too close, what happens is people say, hey, man, I'm not too far away from where they're at. Maybe I can, you know, make a jump up there or something. And you start thinking, well, now, wait a minute, how come I'm seeing it this way? And it gets really problematical, very problematical. Again, I try not to pay any attention to where someone else is at. If I'm listening to some teacher, I try not to judge where they're at too much. It's inevitable, of course you will, but you try not to get into that mode. There's a mode where you just say, I'll just cherry pick what's helpful and leave it at that, and just keep on with my own path, and one day I'll get there. And so that's important, and that's something I have to accept. I have to accept that, and that may be holding me back, because in this egalitarian world we live in, we kind of look down on those who seem to be lifted up to something super, you know, really great. We want to, especially the intellect hates that, because it wants to be exalted, and the way it tries to be exalted is really nuts, equal results kind of thing, which stops the path for everybody, actually, because it says nobody can be on any different point in the path than anybody else. We all have to be on the same page. How is that possible? It is impossible. Cannot do that. That will just stifle everything, cause depression. So everybody's actually on a different page, and that's how it is going to be. It will always be that way, and you know, that's how it is now. Everyone's going at their own speed. Everyone will change their opinions. Absolutely. Every day, how I look at things, how I look at the situation changes every day, and that's been that way the whole way through. Every single day I have a different perspective on it, slightly different perspective, sometimes radically different perspective on it, whereas you know, a week ago, I might have been cursing something and saying, that's nuts, that's crazy, I think that's so wrong, I don't like that. And then now today, I'm saying, oh, now I see it. Because I see it for myself. It's a different thing. Where if someone tells you something, it's a whole different thing than you actually seeing it for yourself in your own thoughts and entertaining and suddenly say, wow, I see it now. I see it. So I saw today that I don't need any problems. I saw it for myself. No one told me that. It's not someone just imposing it. I like a lesson, academic lesson that I say, this is what the teacher wants me to say. So I'm going to say, oh, now I know that I don't need a problem. No, I actually organically, intuitively, clearly saw it and felt the enormity of it for myself. Felt it for myself. It wasn't just a concept. It was an experience. And everyone has to have that. So at some point, teachers have to accept the trappings of being a teacher. And if you're actually enlightened, you really need to accept that and say, hey, I am not like others at this point. Not at all. Because the perspective from enlightenment, you see, you don't have any problems at all, never will. And that's entirely different. You freed yourself from the tyranny of the intellect. You freed yourself from delusion. You are now free of that. Reality has freed us, which we have freed ourselves. We are reality. We are one with reality. And that's a whole different thing. And at that point, you cannot pretend that you're just one of the people. I'm just kind of struggling. I'm just going along. No, because that then people say, wait a minute. If they're just like me and they have this perspective, how come I don't have it? And then they'll start losing faith in their own path is what happens. You can't have that. You cannot have that. So I've been blessed with super teachers where I didn't compare myself with Ramana Maharshi, with Jesus Christ, with Ananda Mai. I said, wow, you know, forget it. You know, they just have it, totally. And so there's no reason for me to even question it. Just forget it. I'll just get all the help I can and keep working at it. So I saw that tonight. I said, wow, that's interesting. Now, Krishnamurti and Anandamaya met one time because they'd heard of each other and they wanted to meet. And I guess some of them around them said, why don't you two meet? And they said, so they met and had a nice talk and meeting, etc. And there was some contention in there because Anandamaya told Krishnamurti, you should allow the traditional forms of reverence to you. As a guru, you should allow people to treat you as a guru. She said, that's very important. And Krishnamurti disagreed. He said, no, nobody bows to me. If they bow to me, I will bow to them. If they touch my feet, I will touch their feet. And he was very adamant about this. And so they had the disagreement. And Anandamaya said, no, I don't agree with that. That it's very important that if you set yourself up and say, I am a guru, I have realized truth, that you allow people to give the due reverence to that and acknowledge that you are now different than them, not in an absolute sense, but in a time-based, hypothetical, scenario-based situation which they're struggling with. You are fundamentally different than they are, fundamentally different, because you realize you don't have any problems and never will, and no one has any problems, whereas they think they have a ton of problems. It's different. It's apples and oranges. And she just said, listen, if you're a guru, you're an orange. You're not an apple anymore. So let people treat you like you're an orange and stop insisting they treat you like an apple. But Krishnamurti would not allow that for himself. And Anandamaya said, well, I see that as you're making a mistake. You're making a mistake. She rarely spoke about that like that way to anybody. I mean, that's the only time I've ever heard her quite talk like that way. Because Krishnamurti could handle it, you know, and she felt like she needed to tell him how she saw things. And first I thought Krishnamurti was right, and I always said, no, he was right. And now suddenly I see, no, he was not right. He was mistaken about that, because he still had some intellect, pride in the intellect was still there, and for some reason he could not allow others to see him, treat him in an exalted manner, because he felt maybe I'm not worthy of that. But if you see that you're problem free and you then it's not that you're worthy of it, it's that the goal is worthy of being acknowledged and revered, and the goal is worthy of that reverence. It absolutely is. Absolutely is. And you have to put your own personality, persona out of the way at that point and let people exalt you, even though you know what it's all about and they may not know quite what it's about. It still has a purpose to it, which is they don't feel any competition with you. They don't feel any competition. They say, look, this one is so different that I don't even want to compare my path, what I'm doing. I don't want to be any comparisons. Forget it. And that actually helps their path a great deal. Helps them. And that's what Ananda Maima was getting at. They're saying, look, it's more helpful for people if you let them acknowledge the goal that you are representing. As a guru, you represent that goal. So she was right. And for her, she allowed it. She allowed it. Didn't identify with it at all. And but she allowed people to have that reverence for her, but she understood it is really for the problem-free state, which we all are already in that state. We've always been in that state. Reality's never had any problems. So that's been a hang-up it's been a hang-up for a lot of people. And for me too, it's like, wow, I don't want anybody treating me anything other than just a normal guy. I don't want that stuff. Because you see some gurus who are not really gurus, not true gurus, are treated with all sorts of pomp and circumstance. And you say, no, I don't want to be identified with that. And the other people, you know, sneer at that and say, ah, see, it's just all a show, just a magic show or something. And if you were genuine, you wouldn't go for any of that stuff. Not true, because the genuine ones do allow that as well. So the intellect not being able to make a discernment just says, let's just throw them all under the bus. Let's get rid of all of them. See? And that's actually a lesser of two evils kind of situation. I mean, it's the greater of two evils. The intellect saying, let's get rid of all of them, is the greater of two evils. Lesser of two evils, meaning it's not a perfect situation, but it's the most effective situation, is to make it clear that those who come to see a guru or teacher, a sage, a clarifier, don't realize that the guru's on a different level entirely, and one that they can't quite understand, really, and they won't understand for a long time. That is true. They will not. I mean, what I saw today, I didn't see yesterday. I've been leading up to it, but the clarity, seeing it, just, oh my gosh, I can really choose to not have any problems, literally. I can literally be free. I realize I can be free. I saw it. This is how you get free. Just accept it for yourself. Accept that you don't have any problems, and literally you'll be in paradise. I was on the fringes of paradise of bliss. I could see it. Oh, that's how it's done. That is how it's done. And I said, I didn't see that yesterday. So at some point, you know, you have to decide, are you going to be like Krishnamurti, or are you going to be like Ananda Maima kind of situation? Or are you going to allow some to say, hey, you know, what you're pointing to is at a whole different level, and we're not there yet. And so we don't want the burden of trying to compete with you at all. We want to say, hey, let's set this one aside. Let's not compete. Let's say this is something that we view differently than any other types of situations in the world. And that's probably necessary. It's probably very helpful, from what I'm saying, very helpful. And of course, the intellect hates that. It wants to get rid of that. Hates it. I don't have much of a problem with it, really. I mean, it's not a big issue. I can see how the intellect, you know, hates it. It's like, oh God, I can't stand this. You know, who do they think they are? Because the intellect thinks that they're just a powerful intellect. They believe the guru is just a powerful intellect, which is totally not the case at all. And so the intellect, knowing its own insufficiencies, secretly the intellect knows that it's really stupid, but it's a great deceiver and trickster. And so it can pretend. It's a great pretender. So all it thinks is that the guru is some great pretender, and it's just a better pretender than most, but it doesn't warrant this type of deference. It doesn't warrant it at all. The intellect gets really aggravated at that. Whereas if you're a charlatan, a shyster, a con artist, etc., the intellect likes that because that is that's one like just like me. The intellect says, see, they're like me. They're just tricksters, and then they kind of say, well, that's okay if they play it up the pomp and circumstance. No big deal. So there's a double standard there. The intellect doesn't mind so much if it's a trickster, but if it's a genuine thing, the intellect says, who the heck, why do they take themselves so seriously? Who the heck do they think they are, kind of thing. And what they know they are, they don't think they are, they know they are problem-free. They don't have any problems, and they will never have any problems. And they've realized that, and they've accepted it, even here in this world, which is a place absolutely teeming with problems. This is what arises when you want to have problems to solve, because the ultimate problem you're trying to solve is how to change reality and then how to deal with the changed reality, which is a problem that will never arise. So this is all hypothetical, but this in this world, of course, we believe that we're here because we believe we have to solve these problems. So we believe we're just saturated with problems. I used to have extremely bad problems, and now I have to admit it's because I wanted to have the problems to solve. I mean, I saw that today. I said, wow, that's why we have problems, because we want to be super solver of problems. But the way to enlightenment is not to be a super solver of problems, is to realize that we don't have any problems. What we are cannot have any problems, never will, and we can release by our drop our desire to have problems, and the world becomes miraculous, becomes paradise for us. People used to ask Ananda Mahatma, do you have any problems? He says, no, I don't have a single problem. Never, my whole life, I've never had a single problem. Never. I've never felt the slightest discomfort or ill at ease, or someone has inconvenienced me. Nothing. She says, no, nothing. It's paradise. He says, everything is perfect here. Everything is perfect. Because she had not the slightest desire to have any problems, or to solve or fix anything, because she knew reality can never have any problems. It's flawless. It's perfect. And she's just saying, hey, this, you too can realize this, can accept it for yourself. That's it. Just accept it for yourself. But doing that is on a whole different order than just conceptualizing it academically. Whole different order. And we can spin our wheels in our entire lives trying to conceptualize it academically and never actually experience it and actually accept it truly here. So the world is simply a miraculous place with you, 100% miraculous place, and you're in paradise. How many have done that here? Very few. It's a whole different order to do that. And those who have done it are actually on a totally different different level, as it were, than those who are simply academically conceptualizing it. And in some cultures, people realize that, and there is this homage and deference to those who have realized it, and they see it's very important to keep that alive, and they're right about that. And what we're doing now in the world dominated by the intellect is we're hell-bent on tearing that down and stomping it into the ground, which is why some people hate saying Merry Christmas, because what are they talking about? They're basically saying all deference and blessings to Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ was one who knew that he had no problems and that there are no such thing as real problems, and nobody has any real problems. He knew it, and he brought it here to the world. And so we pay deference, homage to that, as we should. You don't have to pay homage to the religion. It's not that. It's homage to the fact that there was someone here that knew and still knows right now that we don't have any problems, and we can accept the fact that we're problem-free. That is worth paying homage to and deference to. Forget about the religion. That's not important. That's not important. What is important is there was someone here who knew the truth about the situation and shared it with us. That is super important. So there's nothing wrong with saying Merry Christmas. Where those who are against that, the religiophobes, take it too far is throw out the baby with the bathwater. I mean, there wisdom would say, look, sure, it's a religious holiday, so to speak. Okay, it's a Christian holiday of Christianity. But the wisdom would say, well, so what? It's not worth throwing out the whole thing just to prove a point, an intellectual point? That is stupid. That is the intellect being incredibly stupid, which it is. The intellect's incredibly stupid. And it knows it, but it doesn't want anyone to say that. It gets very upset if you say that. But it's very true, absolutely true. Why? Because it thinks there are real problems. How could you be? That's completely insane. There's no such thing as a real problem. Reality has no problems whatsoever, and only reality is real. There's nothing other than reality. So there are no real problems. There are imaginary problems. But imaginary problems are not, is that the cat? No, that's the wind. Are not real. You don't have those problems. What he does. And that can be realized, it can be accepted. Realization is merely acceptance of this fact. It's just acceptance of facts. That's all it is. But we can try to please, what we're trying to do is we try to please both the intellect and reality at all, both. Either oscillating between the two or at the same time. And that's what causes us all the problems. Because how can we say we don't have any problems whatsoever and accept it eternally, and then at the same time saying, oh yes, but we do have real problems. How can we do both? To do both is insanity. It puts us into depression because it's meaningless. We realize there's no real meaning. I don't think there's no real meaning anywhere. None. And then you get depressed. Then you're in big trouble. Not that you can't get out of it, it's that you don't realize how to get out of it. And when you have a culture which says there's never been anyone here that didn't have any problems, and we got to stamp out any remembrances of that because it's all superstition or it's all crazy religion or something, you have a situation where you have a situation of severe depression in the world, people getting depressed right and left, but 1 in 10 people are on antidepressant medications right now, and you have a situation where the only option people see is taking medications. Which is not an escape. Depression gets so bad that medications don't even help. Or you can be so medicated that you can't even function. Or the side effects from the medication are terrible. So you have a very unholy alliance in the world right now of the intellect, which believes its solution to the problems are what's the answer. Instead of seeing there are no problems, it says, yes, there are problems, but I can fix the problems. So what happens? It uses the intellect to develop all these drugs and then drugs everybody with them. Is what's happening in the world. This is simply a statement of fact. Not hating on anyone, statement of fact. The use of antidepressants and medications to deal with severe mental problems is epidemic. And people just shrug their shoulders now. Oh, you're depressed. Oh, you got severe anxiety. Oh, yeah, I do too. I'm taking this, I'm taking that. Oh, you're taking this? Oh, yeah. Like it's no big deal. Everybody's depressed. You know? That intellect just takes it for granted. Of course we're all going to be severely depressed. You know, what do you expect? It's nuts. And to dampen down the homage to those in this who have been in this world who realize that they don't have any problems and nobody has any problems and there's no such thing as real problems, which is the key, which is the answer, which is our salvation, acceptance of this. They accepted it. They just are here and say, hey, I accept it. I accept it. I'm not here to say I've learned to fix problems. I accept I've never had any problems. That is truth. And for those who come in the world and accept this are extraordinarily helpful for us, extraordinarily helpful. And we should honor them. We should pay homage to them. We should have deference to them in our own way. We don't have to do it in a religious way. Sometimes people organize the deference to them for their own, maybe for some positive reasons to help discipline people and affirm it. And also maybe for their own reasons of the show, How Great the Art Organization or something. I don't know. There's various motivations for it you could look at. But that is no reason to throw out the baby with the bathwater. That is nuts. That is radical. It is radical, and it will result in radically bad results for the world. Without a question. Is 1 + 1 = 2? It's not a guess. That is a certainty. And those results will be dealt with medications, with surgical procedures, with sophisticated biochemical procedures, with genetic engineering, all that stuff. They'll say, your depression is due to a genetic disposition to it. And they'll say, if we can engineer you genetically, we can throw all this nanotechnology within you, that'll get rid of it. They don't even know what the cause of the depression is. They're wrong about that. Absolutely wrong. Depression that is coming is because we don't see any way out other than the intellect, other than trying to fix problems, and ultimately the problems seem insuperable. And when we try to get some wisdom, which we will all do, and we believe we have to oscillate or have both at the same time, both problem-free and problems are real, they're both real, we enter into severe depression. It is inescapable. inescapable. From that position, it is inescapable. And then if we don't have anyone to turn and say, wait a minute, how can I get help? And someone says, well, Jesus Christ can save you, or Ananda Mayama can save you, or Mayor Baba can save you, or Ramana Maharshi can save you, or Krishna can save you, Buddha can save you, Muhammad can save you, etc., etc., etc. If there isn't someone saying that there have been those in this world who accepted that there's that they don't have any problems at all, and no one has problems, there's no such thing as any problems. If that is suppressed, repressed, and stamped out by the intellect, which is the goal of the intellect, that's its goal, you won't have anywhere to turn except medications. You won't have anywhere to turn except medications. Now, in my case, I've been through all of that ahead of time. I know exactly what it's all about. And the medications didn't help me. Didn't work. In fact, it made it worse. 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 They say that oftentimes antidepressants, what they do is they make you just well enough to kill yourself. Which is true. In a lot of cases, that's true. And for me, it made it worse. And I said, none of this stuff helps at all. And yet, the culture of the time said psychoanalysis is the only way. Everything else is myth, superstition. So I tried all that psychoanalysis. It made it worse. Didn't help. And I said, wow, this is bad. But fortunately, I had intuitive understanding of saints from my day I was born, from prior to birth. And I was born into a situation, my family had a library full of all the best books in the world about saints, gurus, sages. And I was studying all that stuff. But it wasn't accepted in the culture, because the psychoanalyst was king and queen. And that was the way you did it. So I tried to do it that way, and didn't work. And finally, I got a hold of A Course in Miracles, and I said, whoa, whoever wrote this, I'm going to defer to them, because they're way beyond any psychoanalyst, way beyond them. Off the charts, completely off the charts. And the writer was supposedly Jesus Christ. And I said, well, whoever it is, you're off the charts, and I'm not going to even compare myself with you at all. I'm going to defer to your knowledge, and knowledge, because obviously, you're way beyond me, way beyond me, and I can tell, and I know that you're pointing towards what is true, and the way to be saved from this depression. So I went with that, and I started getting better, and I've gotten progressively better ever since. Stopped medication, never taken medication since. Never taken it since. No self-medication either. Stopped everything, and never touched it since, and never even been tempted to touch it since. Because I know this way works. So I worked out of the darkest, blackest hole of Calcutta possible, to the point where I'm on the fringes of realization, because I deferred to one that I knew was off the charts and knew the truth, and then later deferred to Ananda Mayama and Ramana Maharshi, saying, you know, you, this triumvirate, you know, I know that you know. And I can't compare where I'm at with you. You are in some different condition altogether, and I'm not sure what it is, but I'm going to listen to you, what you tell me, because I'm going to get there someday. And they said, sure, you're going to get there. Absolutely you will, but you're not there yet. So don't compare yourself with us. And I said, no, that's stupid. I won't compare. That's stupid. Because the realization is so incredible. You just realize you don't have any problems, and you never have had any problems, and you never will. Literally, this is not like some kind of concept I'm telling you. This is a fact. It's a fact that suddenly you don't have any more problems. And I was right on the verge of accepting that today. And I said, oh my gosh, all the stuff, the problems I have now, they will melt away and vanish. They will vanish, and they will be taken care of automatically. And I said, I can accept this for myself right this minute. I can accept it. And I just, it's like, wow. I could go with that. I can really go with that. As I give thanks to the ambassadors of certitude, which are those in the world who are certain that they don't have any problems, they never will, and we don't have, none of us have any problems either. They're certain of it. The ambassadors of certitude, by deference to them and homage to them, you don't have to do a song and dance. You can just not compare yourself with them. Or if you want to, you can do a song and dance too. Which can be somewhat problematical in certain ways. Of course, you can take it too far. whereas the intellect is kind of showing how good it is at deference, which is not the goal at all. But you can just simply have this attitude of not comparing yourself with them and not judging yourself like that, which is, that is sufficient. That is sufficient. And you will see other people putting flower lays on them and you know, bowing and all that kind of stuff. And you don't have to do that. People don't have to do that. Or if some will, some won't. It's not important. But the deference is an inner deference of saying, tell your intellect, hey, sorry, I'm not going to compare intellectually where I'm at with them, because it's not a question of intellect. I can see it. So forget it. And just tell the intellect no. And you have to do that. You have to tell the intellect no. Forget it. I'm not going to be that foolish. This is a whole different situation. There's a different fish in the sea. There's a lot of fish, but this fish is a really different fish, and so different that comparisons is just stupid. It's a waste of time. I'm not going to do it. Then you'll find your progress becomes radical, becomes amazing. And you begin to realize, wait, maybe I don't have any problems. You'll start to consider it. You'll start to really consider it in a certain way, in your own way. You'll start to mull it over, like, wow, can I accept this for myself? That's what you'll ask. Can I really accept this for myself? Is it possible? Little old me, you know, with the stupid intellect I have? And then you realize, well, it doesn't matter what your intellect is like, because that's not even a problem for you either. You don't have, never had any problems. It's not that you had problems and now you don't. No. It's that you've never had any problems. You've only been imagining that you have problems. So the intellect has something to work on. So the dog has a bone to chew on. That's the only reason why. Because you desire to be prime creator. You desire to change reality. That's the only reason. It's not any reason from reality that gave you problems. No. Reality doesn't generate problems at all. And so you mold us over. And you start saying, maybe one day I will accept this. Maybe one day I will. And then you keep working at it, and eventually you get closer and closer and closer. You have a day like me, or like today, like I just said, wow. I'm feeling like I can accept this. Let me see what it's like to accept this. And I felt my mood lifting. I did. I felt my mood be starting to go to exaltation, like the mood was going up in towards bliss. Just a little bit. And I just said, huh. It looks like there's an elevator there. There really is an elevator. I can get in that elevator and just go right up. There's an elevator there. All you do is hit the button and open the door and get inside and hit, you know, top floor and go right up. It's right there. It is right there. I saw the mechanism of it. It's right there. Anytime I can step right into that if I want to. If I want to. And you can too. You can too. But you have to do it. In other words, you can't be outside the elevator and refuse to hit the button, refuse to open the door, refuse to go inside the elevator, refuse to hit up top floor. You can get in the elevator and just not to hit the button to go to the top floor, and you say, okay, I get it. No, you don't get it. You haven't gotten it. Conceptually, you might see the situation, but that's different than actually hitting the button for the top floor and letting the elevator go to the top floor. It's very, very different. Very different. Not the same at all. So I kind of got inside, and I kind of maybe I went to the first floor. I kind of like let the elevator go up a little bit, just a little bit. And I said, ah, okay. I could get used to this. I could get used to not having any problems, actually. My intellect can. Intellect cannot. But it's not my intellect. It's just the intellect. I was infected with it. There's nobody's intellect. Intellect is not, doesn't belong to anyone. Intellect just uses us. Just uses us. Really, it doesn't belong to anyone. It's not my intellect or your intellect. It's just a desire to solve problems and using us, our death, our sickness, our fragility, our insecurity, you know, everything that human body mind represents, symbolizes, using that to say, ah, see, you got a problem. Now listen to me. I know how to fix it. That is the case. You can really turn it around. You really can. It's very doable. And yet there's such enormous taboo against doing it that it doesn't seem easy. Hardly anyone. And sometimes you get in a culture that is accepting of all this, and somebody seems to do it pretty easy. You get the Indian culture in the past where someone said, yeah, I went to a guru, I spent 5 years, and I was enlightened. Well, that was in no small part to the culture that they were functioning in, and no small part, really, in today, in the culture right now, in the Western world right now, it is tough. It is taboo. Very taboo. Because the intellect is king. Or you might say another way right now, actually, the intellect is queen. Because it's even tipped over the point where the female intellect is seen now as superior to the male intellect. That somehow the male intellect failed to solve the problems. Now here comes the female intellect, and the female intellect knows how to solve the problems. And so we've just handed off one description of the intellect for another description. It's the same intellect, but supposedly we're getting an upgrade. the intellect says, no, I've upgraded myself. And now you have the male intellect bowing to the female intellect and says, oh, giving deference. Oh, you let me put you in all the positions of power and you will solve all the problems. You get a Supreme Court justice saying that. She says what she really wants is 9 female Supreme Court justices, and that would be just, you know, that would solve all problems, right? That's the hubris of the intellect, and hiding what it is by saying, oh, there's no problem with the intellect. It's only because this group over here misused it, didn't know how to use it right. But this group over here, they know how to use it right. I'm telling you for sure that is total insanity, and it'll have disastrous results. It is refusing to recognize what the intellect really is, what its goal really is, refusing to accept the fact that there's something greater than the intellect that can guide us, refusing. And it says, no, the only problem is this group over here didn't know how to use the intellect right, and this group over here, they will know how to use it much, much better, and will solve our problems because of that, which is that statement, let's have 9 female Supreme Court justices, as if that's going to somehow solve the problems and of the intellect, and enable the intellect to solve the problems and realize its greatness, which is absolute madness. Shocking madness. To hear something like that from a Supreme Court justice was shocking. It shocked a lot of people, I know. It just, you never would have heard that in the past, really. I mean, well, you actually did hear that in the past. You said, let's have 9 male Supreme Court justices. And no females, saying we know how to do it, the intellect better, that also is shocking. And it's also shocking to say, let's have equal in number, etc. The whole thing is shocking. But in the past, you had Supreme Court justices that had the humility to say, look, we don't elevate the intellect above, there's something greater than the intellect. And there's something we call God or supreme power, something, grace of God, that has better guidance than the intellect. So in other words, you didn't have radical socialist Marxists being Supreme Court justices trying to elevate the intellect over everything. You had those who said, let us do the best we can, but we realize that we're humans, we're fallible, intellect is fallible, let us not raise us up. And so that was a different story. And someone said, well, what she's saying is she really wants 9 radical Marxist progressive female social justices. And if someone said, let's have 9 female conservative Christian justices, right? I don't think she would want that at all. Let's have 9 justices that bow in deference to the prime creator, to God, to the Holy Spirit, etc. I don't think that's what she was getting at all. She's saying, let us have 9 females who worship the intellect as Supreme Court justices. That's what she was saying. And that is shocking. And that should have been a red flag of all red flags, extreme red flag for the world. Said, holy cow, to someone to speak out like this and feel it's perfectly acceptable to speak like this and not feel any shame in doing so is beyond shocking, really. Now, I just say, I saw, what do you expect? Of course. But it is a extreme indication of where the culture is at in today's society. Extreme. And you have people, those in power, saying, you shouldn't worry about that I worship the intellect, because I actually think that females have a greater intellect, so let's put them into power. See, I'm doing that, and so there's no worries. Like, what are you worrying about? You must be sexist or racist if you're worrying. That is how the intellect is twisting things. It is twisting things. What we're worried about is the exaltation of the intellect in all its guises. That is supremely worrisome, because look at the record of what happens when you don't have any checks and balances of such a situation. You have wholesale pogrom becomes genocide, slaughter, war. The record is unequivocal on this. Unequivocal. And of course they say, people, religion causes wars. The intellect brings peace. That is so absolute nonsense that those who say that have taken leave of their sanity, really, because they're not looking at the facts at all. How difficult is it to say, yeah, both can cause a lot of problems? How difficult to say that? Because that's a fact. But how difficult is it to say, let's weigh the two, and which is the lesser of the two evils? That can also be a fact. And I can tell you for 100% certitude, that exalting the intellect is the road to disaster. And those in power in the world now are exalting the intellect. There are those, that is their religion. Their religion is to exalt the intellect. When say they don't have any, they're not religious, that is not true. Their religion. Religion means dedication and devotion to an ideal. And their dedication and devotion is to the ideal of exalting the intellect. And so they are fanatically religious. When we talk about religious fanatics, there's no greater religious fanatics on the face of the earth than those who are trying to exalt the intellect. Those are the most dangerous religious fanatics on the face of the earth, by far and away. I go to Catholic services. Again, I'm not a Catholic, but I go. My wife is a Catholic. I go, and they're not fanatics. I just judge them objectively. I'm just looking at them, and they're not fanatics. They actually have humility. They actually they're willing to admit. Our priest says, "Hey, we're not the only way." He takes great pains to actually say that. He says the Catholics don't have the answer for everybody. We're not the only way. He says we think we're the best way. Okay, well, I respect them saying that. I don't believe they're the best way. I mean, well, I can see maybe they're the best way for some, but not for everybody. And maybe they've got some confusion going on, which I can see they do. But they are not religious fanatics. And I'm just looking at them objectively. I got no reason to say one way. If they were, I would say it. I'm not afraid to say that. I'm not coming from a place of fear. So I'm just saying that they're way less fanatical than those who are trying to, the religion of exalting the intellect. Way less fanatic. To exponent to such a great measure that, you know, you've got, it's just completely out of balance. It's not even close. Not even close. So for me, that's a lesser of two evils. By far and away, if you want to look at it that way, lesser of two evils, because acknowledging that at times the Christian religion has been fanatical and has done very bad things that the fanatics do. At times they did say they're the only way. That's it. There are no other ways. They say that Jesus is the only one who realized that that there's no such thing as real problems. No, he is not the only one. This is a realization that we will all have. And there have been quite a few others throughout history who have had the same realization that there's no such thing as any real problems, that they don't have any problems whatsoever, the reality is totally problem-free, and that there are no real problems at all, anywhere, and none of us have any problems. That is the truth. That is a realization of the truth. And there have been many, not many, but there have been quite a few throughout history who have had that realization, flawless realization, quite a few. And actually, we will all have that realization too at some point. So you cannot say that there's one, that's the only one. That's fanatical. What they're saying is realization that we don't have any problems is the only way, which is, that is true. But they've kind of personified it too much, and there's a backing off from that within the Catholic Church, the Christian churches. There's a backing off. But what's happening is the intellect sees that backing away, and they've taken that as a call to arms to wipe them out. And if the intellect had its way, it would literally wipe out all religion. It would, without any apologies, which is exactly what they tried to do in the Soviet Union, which they tried to do in China, which is what they tried to do in Cambodia, and other situations. Wherever the intellect becomes exalted, the intellect tries to wipe out religion. And how? Well, they think nothing of murdering everybody who's religious. They think nothing of it. They would think that that is, that's their just desserts. They would rationalize it, easily rationalize it, because they'd say, well, they're trying to prevent the intellect from solving the problems that it must solve, and they're not working at it. They don't see the intellect as capable of it, and therefore they're literally working against everyone's salvation, and therefore they're extremely wicked, and their death is the least that they deserve. They've rationalized it that way, and they will. When I say there's problems coming in the world, that's because the exaltation of the intellect has gone so far now, they think nothing of wiping out the religious people, of slaughtering them all, nothing. They don't even feel guilt or a conscience or anything. They think this is simply very, very necessary. In order to save the village, you have to kill the village, wipe out the village. That's the way they see it. So most definitely we're going in that direction, and we're putting people who exalt intellect in all the judge positions of the judiciary, in all the bureaucratic positions, in the political positions, is tilting more and more that way. And those in power are trying to demonize those of people of religion, religious faith, which means they believe there's some greater power than the intellect. That's what religious faith is saying. Hey, the intellect doesn't have the answers and never will. That's a primary article of faith. The intellect doesn't have the answers and never will, which is true. It is a fact. So they're going at least on some factual basis, even if they have, if they're still confused, which they are. The Catholic Church is confused. Okay. That is a fact. I mean, I look at their surface, I look at everything very carefully. There's a lot of confusion there. But there's also some acknowledgement of fact. There's some acknowledgement. So they're not there, but hey, that's par for the course. That's par for the course. I mean, you're going to struggle with confusion. And they're trying to be more honest about it. And yet the intellect takes that as a sign of weakness, a sign that they can now jump them. And they're trying to jump them. They're trying to jump them. And they're trying to demonize the entire, all of religion through the egregious acts of a small, tiny, tiny fraction, segment of out of control priests, etc. And trying to, let's demonize the whole religion. It's all religion's insane. Let's get rid of all of it, etc. That is the actions and the attitudes of those who really want to carry out genocide upon religious people worldwide. It literally is. And that the intellect has already done that. The intellect has already done that. I guess in Turkey, I don't know I believe that intellectual elites got control of Turkey and carried out some, you know, genocide. I'll have to study that more. But I could be wrong on that. But the Armenian situation was a type of severe pogrom in some ways, right? And I don't know what the religious viewpoint of the Armenian people was, but I believe the Ataturk and the whole situation with Turkey was intellectual elites gained control and wanted to set up a secular state, and they acted in very, very, very bad ways. It's just another example. There's many examples. Wherever the intellectual elite gain control, they act in very repressive, very severe ways. I believe Castro was another example in Cuba, who denied God. Communists deny God. Communists make a God of the intellect. Wherever communists have gained control around the world, there have been severe, severe reprisals. Very bad. It's not a joke at all. They're not fooling around. They are not fooling around. And if you can dredge up all the problems of religion, which have been many, but at some point you have to pick the lesser of two evils. You have to, or else you're an idiot. You're an idiot. You're foolish. Say, which is the lesser of these two evils? And I'm saying that religion's a lesser of two evils. And at least there you have something to build on and say, wait a minute, there's some facts here. Let me clear out the confusion. Clear out the confusion, and let's talk about facts. Instead of saying, no, the intellect is supreme, let's exalt the intellect, which is a road to disaster, which is a literal dead end. You will end up dead from taking that path. And we're very close to that dead end right now. Very close. I was shown that during the administration of the 44th President of the United States, we will reach that dead end. On or about that time frame, and we're already in the second term, which means that 4 more years, we're liable to be at that dead end. I was shown that 15 years ago. I didn't have the slightest clue who would be the 44th president of the United States. I don't care who it is. I don't have any. I just said it was shown during that administration, the 44th president of the United States, we will reach a dead end. We will get to that point. And so, unless martial law is declared and the presidency is extended beyond the next 4 years, it's going to come sometime in the next 4 years, or it could have been just after, some very near after another 4 years. Listen to that wind. Whew. Big storm now. So we're close to it. We're close to that. And the red flags are absolutely unmistakable about exalting the intellect. And I am able to clarify all this because I deferred to those who had perfect realization that there's no such thing as any problem. No such thing as problems. No such thing as problems. Totally unreal. The entire kingdom of problems is completely unreal. Totally unreal. It's a mirage. It's a hallucination. It's a fantasy. And we can accept that. Even when we're in this world, we can accept it. We can. It's been done. And they told us we can do it too. And that has nothing, to do with fixing problems. It's really accepting that we don't have any. So, and then turning over the practical pragmatics of our life to the grace of God, which will deal with it. And they assure us that it will. And I'm going to put this to the test. I'm going to put it to the test. Because I got a ton of problems right now. At least it seems that way. I seem to be in an extremely problematical situation, which I acknowledge I must have brought upon myself simply to prove that I can solve these problems. And then to exalt the intellect by somehow solving these problems, I would say, look at the problems I solve. How incredible the intellect is. The intellect guided me to do this. The intellect is God, is King, that kind of thing. Just to do that. So I admit, yeah, that has to be it. I just said, I can't see exactly, but I said, that has to be it. Those are the facts. I have to bow to the facts. I have to bow to the facts. And more I'm seeing, yeah, that's what I did. That's what I did. And that's what we all do. That's what we all do. If we all have problems, we took on the problems to try and exalt the intellect. The intellect talked us into it, as it were. Are we actually desired, because we want to be prime creator, we desired a way to solve the problems of changing reality, etc. So it all gets back to that, and we can't trace. It's hard to trace it back that way. It really is. But I've been able to more or less outline it that way. Haven't filled in all the details yet. We don't need to. We can see the broad outline and just say, okay, I accept that. I can accept that. And then when we accept it, we're free to say, realize, hey, I don't have any problems. I never did. It was just a fantasy. So I'm feeling like I'm at that situation, and the wind is blowing rain into here. You could hear the wind out there. It's pretty strong. So the storm is coming upon us. They said it would come, and here it comes. And I said, there's going to be a storm during the administration of the 44th President of the United States, and it is coming on strong, because there is a push now to put those into positions of authority over us, who their agenda is to exalt the intellect. And when you're in that situation of authority, you start imposing laws and regulations that push this agenda very, very quickly. And you have situations where people who used to defer to a higher power, suddenly they're in a situation. Look what happened with the Orthodox Church in Russia. Look what happened to them. Are you kidding? Look what happened to Tibet. It is Exhibit A. If you want Exhibit A, I mean, it happened in 1955, 1956, when I was born, China annexed Tibet. And look what happened to them. My God, you talk about Exhibit A, if you want. This is a people that lived and breathed religion. And sure, there's some superstitions and myths and excess, blah, 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 of course. But there's also a ton of holy people throughout history in Tibet. A lot of realization happened in Tibet. A lot. There were some really heavyweights. Not all, of course. Of course there's some foolishness that takes place. Of course that's given. I mean, we drive cars and sometimes people get in accidents. Do we want to ban cars because of that? There's some crazy knucklehead drivers out there. You got to be careful of them. Does that mean there's no good drivers? No, of course not. That would just be stupidity to make such a conclusion. And yet we make the same type of conclusion about religion, saying just because there's some knuckleheads, does that mean we got to get rid of all of it? I mean, there aren't any who are very humble and very, and then there's not those who realize the truth or not deference to a higher understanding than the intellect? Of course not. That would be an insane conclusion to draw. And yet, look what's happened to Tibet. Not trying to exalt the people of Tibet by any means, because I know some Tibetans and they can be quite, you know, they can be quite sure of themselves in their own way. They're not all enlightened. They're not all more spiritually advanced necessarily. No, that's not the case. But the situation is, what I'm saying is that the Chinese said, let us wipe out religion here. Let's get rid of all of it. They want to get rid of all of it. And they're trying to. Which is why people are setting themselves on fire. Self-immolation. I've watched some of the tapes of self-immolation. It's not a joke. People are literally dousing themselves in kerosene and lighting themselves on fire and dying. And the Tibetan people bowed down to them. They're not crazy. What they're saying is, look, this is what you're trying to do to religion in our country, is you're trying to annihilate it. And so this monk is saying, or this nun is saying, look, this is what you're doing to religion, and I'm willing to sacrifice my life to show the world what's taking place. And it's not just Tibet, that's just Exhibit A. There's the Soviet Union did it to the Orthodox Church. There are various places that did it to the Catholic Church, did it to the Christian Church, who have done it to different religions. They come in and then they fight out. They try to wipe it out and kill everybody that's involved with it. Either re-educate them or kill them. That's what happens. And so when we are headed pell-mell off the cliff in that direction now on a global basis, of to demonize religion on a global basis and to take radical steps to wipe it out. Radical steps. Even down to the economic level, where you may have to disavow in order to function economically, as a matter of fact. This is the so-called mark of the beast, where you won't be able to do commerce without making some disavowal, without basically acknowledging the omnipotence of the intellect. And they will have brainwave tests or some way to cull people out. They'll have lots of ways to do it. So it's super important now, not that you hate anybody or demonize everybody or get involved in minutia of all this or freak out about it or panic about it. So I'm none of those. Whereas you say, wait a minute, I need to defer to someone who has perfect certitude that we don't have any problems at all. So I can accept for myself, and when you do, the Passover principle will come into play, and you will literally not suffer any problems whatsoever from the future. They can't touch you. Cannot touch you. So that is what is important. That is what I am advocating, that genuine deference to those bastards of certitude. You realize this is the way. Let me be humble. Let me not compare myself. The intellect wants you to compare and say, hey, you're just as good as them. You got a college degree. Who are these people? Ananamayama didn't even have any schooling at all. How can you possibly put her on the same pedestal where you're at? You're greater than she was. That's the intellect will tell you you're greater because you have a PhD. She went to this meeting of religions and had all these people with PhDs and all these degrees and doctorates and all this stuff and doctors and lawyers and philosophers, all these people, this high congress of these intellectuals, and she answered all their questions and she just blew their minds. They said, we not in your category at all. You know, you're way above us. Because they still had some humility at that time. They weren't infected to the state that we're infected now. You got people claiming that the 44th President of the United States is Lord and Savior. And nobody says, bats an eye. You know, this came out recently. Some entertainer, go figure. You know, who would have thought that? Is saying, referring to the 44th President of the United States as Lord and Savior. And of course, when they're called on it, they can always say, oh, I was only joking, I'm a comedian. That is how the radical agenda advances itself in this world, is through comedians, a lot of the way, because comedians can say what can espouse, you know, blow the trumpet for everybody, and espouse the cause and to rally the troops, like, this is where we're going. And everyone says, yeah, I got it. And then when they're called on it, they can say, oh, God, you're so stupid. What an oaf you are. I'm a comedian. I was joking. You don't get it. What's wrong with you? Don't you have a sense of humor? They play that old whiny card, you know. And of course, we just realize that is just how utterly disingenuous that actually is. You don't joke about stuff like that. You do not. What do you joke about heading towards towards genocide? That's a joke, which is where they're heading. That's a joke. And you're joking about no deference to a higher power than the intellect, and you're joking about placing a symbol of the intellect, like a President of the United States, as your Lord and Savior. That's a joke? That's not a joke. That's not comedy. That's not humor. That's deadly serious stuff. Deadly serious stuff. So comedians are, and people are watching these news shows by comedians, and they're just using their comedic twist to advance this agenda of elevating the intellect to the status of Lord and Savior, which is what their religion is. These shows are religious shows, just as much as some Pentecostal preacher hollering about Jesus is a religious, or some televangelist doing a healing convention or show on television. That's just as much a religious show as those are. Just as much. No difference. 100% religious shows. These comedic news shows, etc., are religious shows. 100%. And of course they say, no, it's only comedy. It's only comedy. No, they're worshiping at the altar of the intellect and getting away with it, trying to ease people's concerns. Because of course people are very concerned, because history tells us what happens. And they're saying they're very nervous about it. And so you get these comedians say, ha ha ha, I'm just making a joke. You lack a sense of humor, and you're supposed to laugh at this. What are you talking about? What are you worried about? Nothing to worry about. It's a joke. What's the matter? There's no war against religion. It's all a joke. We're just joking. We're just making jokes, making people laugh. What's the big deal? Of course, that is entirely disingenuous. They are the high priests of a religion, and they are promoting a religion. And those comedic shows, etc., and entertainments are religious shows promoting religion. The religion of worship, exalting the intellect. That's a religion. And there's no difference than some guy in a white suit hitting somebody on the head, you know, and saying, you're healed by the Holy Spirit is healing you. It's even, you know, they're both completely religious shows. At least one has some acknowledgement and deference to Jesus, who had perfect realization that there's no such thing as any problems at all. At least that's there. So it's the lesser of two evils, actually. I'm much less worried about televangelists than I are these atheistic, progressive, Marxist, comedic news shows that pass all this stuff off as comedy, where they're pushing an agenda very severely, actually. And I'm not so much worried, because I know I don't have any problems. I know you don't either. So it's not so much a worry, but it's more like you need to be clear about it, what's going on. It's okay for you to be clear about it. And it's okay if the intellect doesn't like it. Of course it's not going to like clarity about this. It says, they'll say you're an idiot, or you're a fanatic, or you're crazy, or you're racist. See, again, if a white comedian tells the jokes about the agenda of exalting the religion of the intellect, and we say we don't like that, then they'll put up a black comedian. And if you don't like that, then they'll put up a black female comedian. If you don't like that, they'll put a gay black female comedian, or a handicapped gay black female comedian, or whatever, you know, whatever it is, that so they can say that you are nervous about it means that you're a racist, homophobic bigot. And plus, you're completely religious fanatic too. What a, you know, the whole ball of wax. They're trying to assemble this massive ball of wax that says you are terrible. You deserve to die, is what they're essentially saying. You deserve to die. That is what they're saying. Let's just be completely accepting of that fact. When they call you all these names, they're saying in our eyes, you deserve to die, and we are going to find a way to make that happen. That's what they're saying. It's becoming very open now. It's very open. And that's been their agenda all along. If you look at the history, that's what happens. Look what happened to the Orthodox Church in Russia, etc., etc., in Communist China. Look what happened. The pogroms, the extermination, the gulags, the killing fields, etc., etc., etc. That's where it ends. That's where the intellect ends up. That's its religion. It's a religion of death. It's a religion of killing. It's a religion of extermination. And it's being pushed on the world through many ways, but headlining it kind of is the jokesters, the comedians, who are saying that somehow by not accepting this, you're an oaf. You're not cultured enough to get the joke. You're not cultured enough to get the joke. You're not educated enough to get the joke. That's what they're saying. Let's be honest here. They're saying you are not cultured and you're not educated enough, so you're not cultured enough to get the joke. That is, this is just all a joke. It's supposed to be laughed. We're supposed to laugh along the way when following the Pied Piper. We're supposed to be laughing and singing the song. You don't dig the song. You don't dig the tune because you're not cultured enough. And your worries or concerns is because you're not cultured enough. You're a hillbilly. You're a hillbilly. You're a hillbilly. See? And they don't want the hillbillies deferring to some super hillbilly who's telling them the truth. They'll say, oh, you're a cult. If you start bowing and deferring and touching the feet of someone who's telling you don't have any problems, and no matter what the intellect is trying to do for you, kill you, what it's trying to do, it can't kill you because it doesn't have any authority over you. And you don't have any problems, and being killed would be a problem. You could see that as a problem. So you're immune to that. You can actually be immune if you accept it. No one can touch you. Jesus said, no one can touch a hair on my head. If it weren't for I have a mission to show you what's going on here, you couldn't touch a hair on my head, which is a fact. Because he was only pretending to have problems, pretending to be vulnerable, to showcase something. But in fact, he knew he didn't have any problems. No one could touch him. And that's exactly the same fact with you. And there are those that can point this out to you. And the intellect doesn't want you to defer to them. And if you defer to them, it calls you, you're part of a cult. You're some part of a hillbilly cult. Because it feels very threatened by that. It says, no, we must have this egalitarianism and everyone must be on the same page as the intellect. And this one is not talking about the intellect. They're not cultured. You're not cultured. You're a hillbilly. And et cetera. It just goes, foams at the mouth. Foams at the mouth. And it says, look at all this great entertainment we got for you. Everyone's shaking their booty for you. You know, look at this great jokes we have. Look at this culture we have. Look at all this pornography, all this drugs. We'll legalize it all for you. Look at this great culture we have. How can you possibly be listening to some hillbilly guru? How can you possibly be listening? They're crazy. What an uncultured oaf you are. What an uneducated idiot you are, is what they're saying. Say, you're not educated enough to know that you're supposed to die. Supposed to consent to your own death. You're not educated enough. You're not cultured enough. That's what it's saying. It's exactly what it's saying. And of course, if you have a television show and you're one of these Christian conservatives or something, you can't say that because you'll get kicked off the airwaves. You'll be kicked off television if you say that. Anyone that says that, the intellect will go to the moon on that. You know, hate speech. They'll say utter hate speech. Why? Because you're pointing out the facts? How can that be hate speech? It's the intellect that hates. It's the intellect that's the hater. It's the intellect that wants to kill anyone that doesn't worship the intellect. The intellect is a homicidal maniac, as a matter of fact. So, and yet, it's the one that the world is bowing to right now. And the ones that don't bow to the intellect, they're the hillbilly guru. They're the hillbillies. Just ain't got enough education. That's the only problem. You gotta go get some re-education, boy. You'll be fine. You just gotta get that hillbilly out of you, you know. We're all trailer trash. We don't know what we're talking about. White trash or trailer trash of all denominations and both genders, all the races. We got this subculture of hillbillies. So we just don't know what we're talking about. We need the intellect to educate us. So there's that pressure. It's extreme pressure. And I was blessed enough to grow up in a situation where I was exposed to all that at an early age, and I could work my whole life to work through it and see through it all. So I'm kind of immune to the pressure. So I can say these things. And I know I'm not a hater at all. Not at all. I don't hate anybody. Don't even hate those who worship the intellect. But I will point out the road they're going down. And I will point out the danger of it. And it's a danger to themselves too, because what happened in the Soviet Union, the Soviet Union belief, intellect devours itself. So you had Stalin in the maximum security prison, maximum security jail cell, having jailers first taste his food in front of him and then push the food that they tasted underneath the door to him, and nobody could get to him, and living in absolute terror. That's the leader of the whole thing. That's how he spent the last days of his life. He wasn't in some pomp and circumstance in some court, because everybody else had been killed already. Because they didn't worship the intellect enough. The intellect said, off with their heads. Because I'm not solving the problem, because that general doesn't know what he's doing. He's probably some crazy religionist. Kill him. And that general too, and that one too. As the intellect fails to solve the crises that it brings upon itself, which it always does, it just starts pointing blame. Blame this one, blame this one, and you have pogroms within the ranks of the Politburo, which is exactly what happened. And everyone got assassinated, and then so Stalin was the only one left, and he was afraid of being poisoned, you know. So he had to have his jailers test the food before he gave it to him. Yeah, those are real hillbillies, you know. Really, those who worship the intellect are the real hillbillies, dangerous hillbillies. Very dangerous hillbillies. Dangerous trailer trash, really. And they're in control. The inmates are in control of the asylum right now. So, it's super important that you get your house in order and don't fall for their pressure. And it's not easy. It is not easy. I don't know how to deal with it, tell you the truth. Because obviously, if I accept that I don't have any problems, I'm going to be in a completely blissful condition, and people are going to realize that this one is very different than other people here. This is a completely different situation here. They're going to see it. So how do I deal with that? You know, that's on my mind. How the heck do I deal with that? If I say, like Christian Murdy, and go, no, I'm just the same as you. Well, that's not true. That would not be true. It only on the most abstract level is a fact, but pragmatically, it is not a fact. You cannot just toss the pragmatic out the window. That's not smart. That is not smart. It's not helpful. So I might have to go in a situation where I have to accept deference for myself. And I have to say, well, okay. But then, of course, if I do that, then the intellects, those who are worshiping the intellect, which includes the atheists, of course, They're gonna go crazy. They're gonna get like, say you're like a nut. This is a bizarre cult leader, you know, some Heaven's Gate bizarre cult leader trying to lead everybody to death, which was projection of the intellect. Okay, that's what the intellect is projecting. Anyone who is in that position must be leading a cult, Jim Jones, Heaven's Gate cult leader, leading everybody to death. It must be the true. That's their hillbilly trailer trash projections, that what must be happening from these uncultured hicks that are crazy, going, giving, accepting deference for themselves, thinking that they're somehow so much greater, blah, 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 blah. You get that dynamics in the world. That's exactly what's in the world. So it makes it very difficult for anybody who's truly enlightened to come out in the world now. Because, so what you get is a whole bunch of people come out in the world who are not enlightened, or who are not quite adamant enough. I mean, I there are some teachers that I respect. I don't bow to them because they're not on that level of perfect certitude, at least from how I see it. I could be wrong. So they're not quite adamant enough, in my opinion. They're kind of playing the game a little bit. They're kind of giving deference to the intellect in some ways. In some ways they are. In some ways. Maybe that's the way the game needs to be played now. I don't know. So I'm not an absolute, I'm not stating, you know, this is fact. This is conjecture. It's conjecture. It's educated conjecture. It would be pretty difficult to be like Anandamayi was at this time in this world. It would be pretty. Wouldn't be easy. And people, I think, might really rip into her. I mean, really criticize her. And those who deferred to her would be seen as kooks, cultists. Absolutely, they would be characterized that way, which makes it difficult. Because then your family would say, "Oh, you're following some cult. I'm worried about you." I could say, no, you're following the cult of the intellect. That's what results in death and slaughter and genocide. That's cult. Just because numerically there's a majority doesn't mean it's not a cult. The intellect tends to say that cults are like these small cults, you know, 20 people, 100 people, 1,000 people. That's a cult. They say, well, if there's, you know, half the world or more than half the world is following the religion of the intellect, that can't be a cult. The definition of a cult is that it's dangerous and it's destructive to its members and can result in harm, etc. So the religion of the intellect is super dangerous. It's a super cult. It's a super cult. We can call that a super cult. And it tries to project that and deny and project its own cult-like, super cult danger onto others and say, no, that's the dangerous cult there. And you have those who are wishy-washy, trying to please both the intellect and God. So then you get dangerous situations. You get a Heaven's Gate, you got a Jim Jones, People's Temple. You get that side of the situation, trying to mix the two, trying to please both. Then you have a dangerous situation. There's no question about that. So you need to look out, you know, look out for that. No question about it. But or the religion of the intellect is super dangerous because it becomes a global cult. And then you have, you know, a global genocide. You have a true one religion, and it becomes vicious. So we're just, as this storm comes in, I'm feeling like, hey, you know, yeah, storms do come in. The forecasts do turn out to be accurate. So I'm like a meteorologist taking, you know, using a lot of stuff in awareness that I have to make a forecast. And these meteorologists here in the Bay Area, they said, hey, around 4 o'clock, this storm's going to come rolling in. It has a lot of moisture. It's going to drop a lot of water. It's going to be a heavy soaker. It's going to be probably some flooding, maybe some flash flooding. It's going to be powerful. It's going to be strong. It's not the arc storm. It's not the mother of all storms. No. But it's going to be a strong soaker. And so far, it's showing up to be accurate. And they said the heavier stuff's coming in later tonight and actually into Friday morning. We'll see if they're accurate or not. Probably will be. So this forecast that I'm giving about the world, I would say is probably going to be accurate. Pretty darn accurate. It's trending that way in every possible way. Every possible way is trending that way. It's just following the blueprint to the T. So, you know, if I would say, no, there's no problem, I'd be an idiot if I said that. If something is following a blueprint, you know the blueprint. It's been shown before in history, and those who are very wise are saying this is a blueprint. You say, yeah, this is probably the blueprint. And then if it's following the blueprint to the T, how can you say it's not going to build up, you know, what the blueprint shows it's going to build? You'd have to say it's going to. You'd be disingenuous to say it would not. Be disingenuous to say everything's going to be fine. Those who say everything's going to be fine in the world, I really see it as they're very disingenuous. And those who are religious leaders and those who are spiritual leaders who say everything's going to be fine, if they mean that socially, culturally, everything's going to be fine, they're being entirely disingenuous because it's not going to be fine. If they mean that none of these problems are real and you don't have any real problems and you can accept that and you can sidestep the whole problem in the world and not be untouched by it, then I would agree. But I haven't heard them stating it that way. They're wishy-washy about it. They haven't come out adamantly and say, this is what I'm saying. You can be saved from the problems because you can realize that there's no such thing as a problem. You don't have any problems. It's all a fantasy. And when you see it's a fantasy, so there's no reason to act it out. Whereas there are others in the world who don't see it's a fantasy, and they're certainly going to act it out. If you put it that way, then I can agree. You know, that is truth. But I don't hear it being put that way. The spiritual leaders of the world are kind of, I don't know what they're saying. They're kind of saying, there'll be some problems, but we'll get through it just fine. We'll have a golden age. Really? How is that going to happen? What are you going to do with all those who are worshiping the intellect? What are you going to do? Re-educate them? Because you'd have to have a golden age. You couldn't possibly reach a golden age the way we're going. Not possible. You're going to reach a genocide the way we're going. Planetary genocide is what you're going to reach. And extermination is if it's unchecked, that's what's going to happen. And how can you check it except you have to re-educate those who are worshiping the intellect? And is there any mood for that in the world right now? No, there is not. There is not. Now, there's some trickeration going on. I say, well, we need to come to a compromise. You got activists saying, you know what, we don't really want to demonize religious people too much because that wouldn't be smart. And you know, blah, blah. That's just a stalling until they can gather enough oomph to push it through. It's just now the intellect, the worship of the intellect is a severe, severe disease, severe delusion, very severe. And generally, they don't come out of it. They end up going down with the ship. It's tough to come out of it, very tough. I was trapped in an attempt to help. I got trapped into it in some ways. I had a very tough time. I'm telling you, it is tough to get out of that syndrome of worshiping the intellect, that religion. It's a cult, and it's tough to leave a cult. Very tough. Because they say, hey, if you leave this cult, we'll never accept you back in it, and we're going to kill you if you leave that cult, and you're going to suffer the world of damnation, and you're going to be alienated eternally, you're going to suffer eternal damnation, on and on and on and on. They infer that that you are never be accepted back in, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they pressure you, and they scare you, and you can't, you know, you're afraid to leave the cult. Because they say that you are proving that you are not worthy by leaving. It's proof. It's proof. It's a tough situation. Very tough. Fortunately, in the 20th century, there were ambassadors of certitude in the world that we got the chance, there were those who got a chance to see them, actually, meet them, be in their presence, and then pass it on to those who didn't have a chance. That, you know, say, hey, I really did meet this ambassador of certitude. I'm telling you, this is a whole different situation. Don't worship the intellect. That's wrong. I'm positive it's wrong. I met someone who is totally beyond the intellect, and they're fabulous. They're not some hillbilly hicks at all. At all. So don't go that way. Enough of that seeped into the culture that we picked up on it. We're very fortunate. Those who grew up in the 50s, the 60s, and the 70s, even the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, even the 80s, very fortunate people. And you need to realize your good fortune because that seeped into culture. There's enough of that seeping into the culture that you could catch that vibe and you could say, hey, I'm not going to worship the intellect. No way. No way. But those who have grown up in the digital age with all these gadgets, the intellect is... You know, they're saying, wow, look at all this cool stuff. You guys didn't have that back in the... And all these commercials say, oh, how unfortunate you were back in the day when you didn't have, you know, a wireless television that you could go anywhere you want. You didn't have all these channels. You didn't have smartphones. You didn't have GPS. You didn't have cell phones even. Oh, how unfortunate you were. No, I would say it's just the opposite. How supremely fortunate we were to not be worshiping the intellect, to not be tricked by these trinkets. Of the intellect's been giving us these trinkets, these gaudy trinkets, really, in comparison to what's really offered to us by that which is beyond the intellect. These are just simply gaudy trinkets, you know, that's all they are, at the most. How fortunate we were to not have those and to catch the vibe from those who went to see these ambassadors of certitude, and they told us, hey, there's someone over there in like Tibet or India or wherever. I mean, they weren't in Tibet after 55. They had to flee to, where was it? Dharamsala or something. They had to flee, but various places in the world. How fortunate. I mean, there was one in Pine Valley, of California. Franklin Merrill Wolfe had a pretty high degree of realization. I wouldn't say it was total certitude, but it's pretty profound. Those who went or who were in his presence wasn't on the same level as like Ananda Mahima was not. But there were those around the world that people would say, hey, there's something beyond the intellect. Franklin Merrill Wolfe realized there was something beyond the intellect for sure. He realized that. Because he was an extreme intellectual, super smart guy, a mathematician, a genius. And he realized that spirit, there's something beyond this entirely. He realized it. So, there's an example. But there were a lot in India, a lot of India and in Asia, and some in the Western world. There were some in the Western world. how fortunate we were to be aware of this. And say to the intellect, wait a minute, intellect, you're tricky, you're smart, you're ingenious, you're inventive, but there's something that blows you out of the water, completely beyond you, completely better than you. So I'm not going to get carried away with anything you do. So we didn't get carried away. We rode out this wave of the high technology and all this stuff, and we're not overawed by it at all. We're not awed by it. Not awed at all. No, not awed. We can use it like this, but we're not in awe of it. We don't say, hey, the intellect's so incredible. How awesome is the intellect? No. Very clever. Very clever. Very ingenious. So what? It's got another clue about salvation. It's clueless. And I know I can be saved. So why should I worship the intellect? I don't. I give it its due. Give the devil its due. Give the devil its due. Yeah. I'm using the technology here because it's helpful to others. It's not a problem. It's not hypocritical or anything. I acknowledge the facts. The intellect's very clever. Materially clever. Dealing with energy, doing all this stuff is very clever, very inventive, very industrious. All this stuff. Sure. I'm not arguing with that fact at all. I'm just saying, but. Yeah. Big problems with the intellect. Big problems with this religion of the intellect. Big problems. And of course, all its churches say, where are its churches? How can it be a religion if it don't got a church? You know, and say, well, the universities, the school system, high schools, the universities, the colleges, graduate programs, all that stuff, those are the temples, those are the synagogues, those are the churches, those are the mosques, those are of the religion of the intellect. That's what those are. And where's the convocation of, you know, a religion? Well, you have all these secret societies, the not-so-secret societies of the elites and the Illuminatis and all those, the stuff. Those are like the Pope and the Cardinals and the Bishops and the meetings and all that kind of stuff. They have their own structure to their religion. They absolutely have a structure to it. They absolutely do. And they're in competition with the other religions, all the while denying that they are a religion, as if they have some kind of moral high ground, because they say, we've never done anything wrong, morally wrong. Oh, no. Oh, no. Which is, of course, that is, if it weren't so deadly serious, that would be comedic. You know, if they want to be talk about comedians, they actually are comedians. They don't realize it, how comedic it is that they say these things. But it's really the comedian of ludicrous. Farcically ludicrous and not actually not so funny, because it's a deadly thing to accept this. But it is, you have to chuckle at the audacity, the sheer audacity to the stuff they say. Sheer audacity. To say something like that. Oh, we, huh, us? The intellect? Oh, the intellect's never done anything wrong. What are you talking about? You're crazy. Yeah, the audacity to say that is quite humorous. It's quite funny. And they stay with a straight face and look at you like, you crazy boy? What are you laughing at? You know, you must be crazy. What are you talking about? They kind of look at you like, huh? You need some meds, boy. I got some re-education for you. that's a look. Like, I think I know a good therapist for you. I need to find a good therapist for you. And I bet you a therapist can fix you up with some good medications, and you wouldn't be chuckling at what I just said, because he got kind of some warped sense of humor, huh? Something like that. And you get that, right? You get that. Absolutely, that's the attitude that's being pushed on us. Like you got some kind of warped sense of humor. Why are you chuckling at what we're saying? We're dead serious. We never, intellects never hurt a fly. And never would hurt a fly. We never hurt a fly. What are you talking about? We're the ones that gave you these gadgets. We're the good guys. We do no evil. We wouldn't do no evil. Only do good. We'd only do good. What are you talking about? What about you? What do you mean you're worried about monopoly? And what do you mean you're worried about that? Well, you guys are crazy. You need to get re-educated, boy. You got some problem with education. You got some kind of hillbilly. You weren't educated properly, and so you get that whole spiel, that whole act, that whole song and dance. That's what we're all getting. You know, where is somebody who stands up to this and is ambassador of certitude in the world? I would sure like to find them. And there's some who are kind of like that, which is helpful, But I'd sure like to find a full-blown one at some point. Full-blown one, you know, just dismisses this song and dance and whole spiel of the intellect. Just laughs at it. Just laughs at it. Fun. Just, you know, just smiles and laughs it off. And is not the slightest bit intimidated or bothered at all. This would be great to find someone like that in the world. And we have to move that direction ourselves. We have to help one another in this world. And if somebody can get free, then of course we recognize that and we defer to that and say, ah, here's an example. Example A, you know, prime example, that's great. And we need to recognize that and defer to it and not get intimidated by it. Because the intellect is becoming extremely intimidating. It is an extreme bully. It is bullying us. And we don't even know the extent. I'm trying to bring out the extent that it's bullying us here. As part of these videos, show you how severe the bullying really is. We may not realize it. We think, it's just kind of, you know, pushing us around a little bit. No, it is very severe. Because when you try to stand up to it, to the extent you should stand up to it, that is when the bullying gets severe. And that is when they say, you need to be in a locked, padded room with the meds and a straitjacket. And then maybe at some point in time, a couple decades from now, we'll start trying to re-educate you. But first of all, you really got to, you know, lock you down. That's the kind of bullying that they'll put on you. They'll give you that attitude. They can see perfectly clearly that they're dealing with a lunatic. It's just they got to figure out how to deal with this dangerous lunatic. That is what you get from those who are these religious fanatics of worshiping the intellect, is they view you as a dangerous lunatic, very dangerous lunatic, and they're just kind of figuring out how can they deal with you? What can we do with this? That's the situation we're at. We're at loggerheads, you know, it's a bad situation. And of course, those who know that there's no such thing as a problem, they truly are harmless as a fly. They truly are harmless. Because they say, what was the problem? I don't have any problem. There is no problem. There is no real problem. But to those who don't yet realize that it can seem to be a very, very bad problem. And so what is the cure? To realize you don't have a problem. That is a cure. Not to see that the problem is real and there's a way to fix it, but to see that the problem is not real, and you are real, and therefore you don't have any real problems at all, none. And this may seem to be like a big leap to take, right? It is like a big leap. It's a realization. That's why they call it realization or illumination or enlightenment, is to go from, you say, no, it can't. That can't be really factually true. They must be metaphorically. No, it's not a metaphor. It is not a metaphor. It's actually factually true. You don't have a problem at all. I don't have a problem at all. I don't have any problem at all. Not really. Every problem I have is just a fantasy. And it's a fantasy, and I'm entertaining it. I'm entertaining a fantasy. That's literally true. So it is a big jump to go from thinking that, well, this must be just a metaphorical means of talking about something else, to realizing, no, this is actually a statement of fact. That is a shift. That is a shift. And that's a big shift. And those who have made that shift, it's wise to have deference to them. Not big some egoic deference. No, it's just wise to have deference. Otherwise, the intellect's going to smoke you. It's absolutely going to smoke you. You have to realize you have an adversary. You have an adversary, which is the intellect and the religious fanatics of the intellect, who will absolutely smoke you if they can. Because you haven't yet realized you don't have a problem. You're still entertaining them as if they're a problem that you can fix. You're still thinking, how do I fix the problem of these religious fanatics who are worshiping the intellect? How do I fix that problem? Then you're in harm's way. Then you're in big trouble. Or if you get to the point you realize, no, they're no problem. I don't have any problem. How can I have a problem? It's impossible. Last night I saw it. It is impossible that I have a problem. And today I started to accept it. So last night I saw it from a standpoint of clarity, conceptually, I said, it is impossible that I have a problem. And I saw why it's impossible. And then today I said, let me kind of, how does it feel to not have a problem? I started that. So I could be enlightened at some point. That's possible. Eventually I will. You will too. Everybody will. But if I'm at the point where I'm kind of saying, how does it feel to have no problem? Then I'm getting close. That is true. But not there yet. Not there yet. But better get there quickly. We all better get there quickly. That is for sure. And, you know, realistically, we're not all going to get there real quickly because I can tell that people are struggling. People are struggling. It's not easy. Of course you struggle if it's not easy. It's like getting a hole-in-one, on a golf course. Hole-in-one's not easy. I never had a hole-in-one. Never. I've come close. You know, I've had shots that landed on the fly like a half an inch from flying into the cup, but they didn't go in. So it is not easy. But it's easy to hit the shot, sure. I could sit there all day hitting shots. That's not difficult, but to get it to go in is not easy. So, of course, not everybody's going to realize it right now. They don't have a problem, of course. So what do you do then? Well, pragmatically, there's going to be something. On a pragmatic level, there is going to be some disposition of some sort. But I'm not going to try to pin that down right now because I have to focus on myself accepting how does it feel to not have any problems. I have to do that. Otherwise, I won't be helpful to you. Because at some point, there has to be those who realize that they've accepted feeling that they don't have any problems so they can convey the Passover principle to others and that others can say, okay, I feel this is the right way. Not just conceptually, but kind of feel it's the right way and then say, I'm going in that direction of I know I can one day feel that I don't have any problems. I know I can do it, therefore I'm not going to accept consent to die. I'm not going to consent to any of that stuff that the intellect demands of me. I'm not going to consent to it. And at that point, there will be a Passover principle will be applied in some way. So you will not succumb to the demands of the intellect. You will not. So this is serious stuff we're dealing with here. And my own path is a serious thing. I take it with utmost seriousness, utmost. Which is why in the nighttime, I'm thinking of it. When I wake up at 5 in the morning, I spend 3 hours till 8 in the morning. I have to get up and get going. I spend focused on it. And then I come home. It's storming out here. It's raining. It's all stuff. I'm doing like a two-hour video. Why? Because I want to hear myself talk? No, because this is serious stuff we're talking about. Super serious stuff. And it is no joke at all. We have got to succeed in a sufficient measure. Have to. It's just no way around it. So putting in the time now is time well spent. If you put in every spare moment of the day, you're doing the right thing. And I'm not sitting here, watching television, okay? I'm here giving it 100%. Every day, 100%. And occasionally, I might take a little, a little break where I'm just like, wow, I'm just exhausted or something. Maybe. I'm not going to beat myself up for it. But at the same time, I try to limit that, too. I try to limit it. And it's good that it's not baseball season anymore because I might be watching the baseball games. It's a great time. 4 months, no baseball. Hey, for me, I say, hey, time to go for it. Go for broke because we've got 4 months with no baseball. If the baseball season starts, I might say, I got to find out what the Panda's going to do this year. I got to find out what the Giants are going to do and blah, blah, blah. Because it's a pastime that I've used to keep my sanity and keep me going throughout life. It's a crutch, and I've used it. It helped me out. Helped me out a lot. Just have something to tune into in a state of such isolation, ideological isolation I was in. I just wanted to have something I could relate to. Because again, I abandoned the intellect. And in doing so, I lost all my friends, lost all my position in society and culture. Everybody thought I was a hillbilly and knucklehead. And somehow I lost my way and I was the black sheep. And I was kind of crazy and didn't know what I was talking about, and they felt sorry for me, but I lost it all. Lost all my gravitas in the culture. So I was told so isolated, and so I just, even from a young age, I knew I was isolated, and people didn't agree with me. So I just followed baseball and just listened to baseball games for entertainment and just said something to feel like I was connected to the world somehow. And so it got me through all these years, 51 years of following baseball, really, for me. And my team, the Giants, had just won 2 world championships. And it's pretty fun to see that happen. But I'm over it, you know, but I'm still smiling about it. But it's a trivial thing, and I recognize it's trivial, and I have it in perspective. It doesn't prevent me from, you know, all-out effort here. But like I say, 4 months. December, well, I've had November, December, January, February, March. That's 4 months. And then the baseball season doesn't start till April. So in those 4 months, I'm going to go for broke. I'm going to go and try to help everybody as much as I can, because I know there's a great need for help. And now the heavens have just opened up right now, and it is absolutely pouring. You can hear it, probably. Take a listen. It's like deluge right now, almost. It is a downpour. This is what we're supposed to get. This is the Pineapple Express from Hawaii. This is the tropical, subtropical moisture. It's getting pulled up and getting into the jet stream and pushed into the Bay Area in Northern California. And this stuff is heavy moisture content, because of course with warm air can hold more moisture. And when it hits the cold air from the Gulf of Alaska, that just wrings the moisture out of it. And it will just kaboom. It drops. That's when you have flooding. That's when you have El Nino year. When you have Pineapple Express here in Northern California, and Central California, you get the flooding. And we've had bad flooding here, actually, in El Nino's past. We had some amazing stuff, inundations. But you don't have the storm surge that you had back east with Sandy. You don't have the storm surge. No, you don't have like that. You get high waves, but not the kind of storm surge that a hurricane brings. No, not like that. It's not like that at all. So people back east are thinking, oh, I hope you're okay. We're fine. We're fine out here. We're perfectly fine. Don't have no worries whatsoever about us. I've read on the internet and stuff where people are like freaking out about these storms that are coming to California, and they think it's like Sandy or something. It is, has no bearing, like no similarity really at all. Forget about it. It's just some rain. It's all. This is nothing. It's nothing. We'll have some, you know, incidental small floods from creeks and things like that. It's just standard stuff. No, Sandy was nasty, really terrible. That was no joke at all. But of course, Californians freak out about any weather. Really, they freak out. How am I going to function? We're all absolutely fine here. No worries. No worries whatsoever. So, before the electricity goes out here, this is actually on a cord, and the cord can it gets in storms, safety gets triggered, and the fuse gets triggered and goes off, and I'll lose electricity here. The lights will go out and everything. So it hasn't happened yet, which is a blessing. But with the way these winds are going, it might very well happen. So we have covered a lot of territory here, and I'm really airing it out. It's like if you're a hitter, a batter, it's like I'm swinging for the fences, basically. There's a time to try to hit singles, off-field singles, try to pull the ball down the line, try to get a walk, maybe a bunt, and maybe a double, drive in the alley, drive in the gap, and then there's a time to go for the fences. There is a time where you simply are trying to hit a home run. You're going for it. There are certain times where you say, I got to hit a home run now to win this game. If I don't, we're not going to win. So I realize that now is the time I have to hit a home run. So, you know, go, just, you know, and then you take a different swing. You know, and you try to guess the pitch. You try to anticipate the pitch. You say, this is going to be like, I'm expecting like a hanging slider, backup slider. And it's going to be probably inside. I'm going to get deep in the box. I'm going to back off the plate a little bit. And I'm going to absolutely load up on this pitch. And when I see this pitch and coming in a certain situation, I'm going to absolutely torque and cut loose with the fastest bat speed possible and follow through on it and hit it out of the stadium. And when you see that pitch, you absolutely jump on it. And you just absolutely crush the ball. That is a home run swing. And so right now, it's time to hit a home run. It is time to hit, take a home run cut. Like the pitchers do, they swing real hard. They say, well, I'm just going to swing as hard as I can in case I hit the ball. And they don't hit it very often. So they're just swinging wild, just trying to, but we're here, now we're not swinging wild. This is not wild swings. This is disciplined plate approach. This is recognizing where the ball is going to be, how to put the right swing on it, everything, and where to hit it, and it's trying to hit a home run. We're trying to hit a home run here. So I'm saying stuff I wouldn't ordinarily say. Wouldn't ordinarily out the intellect and those who are pushing this religion. I wouldn't speak this way. I haven't spoken this way before, not this strong. But it's getting to the point where if we don't speak up, it's going to be too late. And you have these people saying stuff that is crossing the line. There is a line, and they've crossed it. They're crossing the line now. It's like the Nazis going into Austria or Czechoslovakia or something. You cross the border, you cross a certain line, and say, hey, wait a minute, you've just broken the truce, my friend. We had truces. You can't do that. This is war. You've declared war. You've crossed the line. We had truces. You can't go this far. When you have people saying some of the stuff that I've mentioned in this video, and then say, oh, it's comedic, but no, your Lord and Savior, the President, and putting out posters like in the crucified Christ, you know, posters of the President and things like that, and you have those who the Supreme Court Justice, you know, is making this the statement that she made. That's crossing the line. That's declaring war. Really, it's really declaring war, because the war that is the war. It's not armed conflict. It is ideological conflict, which leads to extermination. It's an ideological conflict. And there are certain truces that keep the balance of power so it doesn't go in that direction. And when you break the truce, you cross the line, you've broken the truce. And you have given up any right to not be commented on in an adamant way. You've given up that right. That's the situation. I say, hey, it's time to say something. Of course, that is just reminding you must accept the problem-free situation and be humble enough to defer to those who have. As I do, for absolutely all thanks to Jesus Christ and Anamaima and Ramana Maharshi and all the others who have paved the way, who have enabled me to be where I am right now. It's because of them, period. Without not for them, no way would I be here. No way. It's because of their great, great boost that they have given that I'm able to be here. And as a matter of fact, those of you who are able to understand this, somebody has helped you. You may not know who they are, but they have helped you, absolutely. Listen to that wind. Whew. Wow. Wow, that's going to knock down some trees. That is going to knock down some trees. And that's going to knock electricity out. I went out and got some batteries yesterday. I don't know if I have a flashlight, but I got some batteries. I actually have LED flashlights, small ones, which are really cool. They take like a one AA battery or a couple of AAAs or something. And the one with the AAAs are bright, really bright. I should have got one today. I don't know why I didn't. I could have. And the one with like a single AA, one AA is strong, is bright. That's all you need, really. You don't need this big flashlight with two D batteries or something. And those LEDs last a long time. What, they say like 100 hours with one battery, 100 hours or something. Wow. Very useful to have. You're not going to need it for 100 hours, right? I have one of those. That's okay. That's fine. We're fine. I've got a barbecue with some propane. Need to cook something, cook it on there. Got a gas stove. You can light that with a match. So, yeah, no worries. The trees will come down with a storm. I just heard there. Wow, that was like about a 40 mile an hour gust right there. We're expecting gusts up to 60, possibly 80 in some places. That's pretty strong. That'll knock down trees. So who knows if we're gonna have power here? I don't know. If we don't have power, I don't want to be able to give videos out. So this one should take care of the next couple. This one. If I can't tape, it's probably because I got the power and I got knocked out. and this one should take care of it, because it's got a lot of stuff in here to ponder on, to consider, and to realize that the truces are being broken right now, right and left. I've told you that November would be the month of consequential action, and it is. These statements that are being made, those are consequential actions. Those are breaking the treaties. Those are treaty breakers. Those are treaty breakers. No two ways about it. And we have a lot of those right now. A lot. Where the intellect is simply exerting its power and authority. The high priests of this religion are exerting their authority and calling and playing to the fanatics out there and saying, look, it's marching time. It's marching time. It's like the SS. Time to march into Austria or something. The stormtroopers, the Waffen stormtroopers, time to march into Austria. It's like that, except on a subtler level, on an ideological level. The ideological stormtroopers are making their move. And I told you what happened, and it is happening. And that's not a joke. It is not anything other than a situation where, again, not called to confrontation, not called to hatred, called to humility. Call to humility. Humility is your salvation. It is. It is your salvation. And being wise enough to defer to those who, through their humility, have been able to hear and accept that they don't have any problems. And therefore, they've never solved any problems, and they never will solve any problems, and that's okay. That's okay. Because nobody has any problems. That is true humility. It's truth. It's reality. That is the path of your safety and salvation. So bank on it. Bank on it. All right. There we go. We reached 2 hours. Fantastic. And I have got to go in and get people dinner, because that's what I do. That's what I do. All right. Very great. Have a very great day, evening, morning. And, Stay with the truth, because, and then the truth will stay with you. That is absolutely so. All right, that's it.